prizes, including a trip to space camp in Belgium and $1,000 cash.
Their new album, A Rush of Blood to the Head, just went platinum in Canada. It debuted number one here and in 11 other countries. Please, a big warm welcome for a band that is gonna give you goosebumps, Coldplay!
Everyone must find a place. Give me time and give me space. And give me real, don't give me fake. Give me strength, reserve control. Give me heart and give me soul. Give me love, give us a kiss.
Oh, gotta say I'm on my way down. God give me style and give me grace. God put a smile upon my face.
Thank you.
thought of all the stupid things I'd said.
Spending your evening with us. If you have a question for the band, give us a call, send us a fax, or drop us an email. Details on how to do that in just a bit. We're taking a commercial break, but very soon we're getting interactive with Coldplay. Stay with us. Questions, but first, I have a few. Your album debuted at number one. What does that mean to you? What does that say?
It says that it's the best in the world ever. It doesn't say that. It says we've got immensely intelligent marketing people.
who can really fool a lot of people.
You're at the top.
It's cool. You know?
You're at the top right now with artists like Avril Lavigne, Eminem.
Hey, whoa.
Hold on. The question continues. Nelly, who you cover Hot in Here at your concert, also at your show, you joke with the audience saying that you're the new Bon Jovi. So are you comfortable being associated with all these other popular artists in the mainstream?
Absolutely. It's what we dreamed of.
Absolutely.
But I think you're still a bit different. I'm wondering if Coldplay is the alternative to a lot of mainstream music fans.
We're like the NSYNC It's Okay to Like, you know? We're like, when girls hit 16, they change from NSYNC to either us or someone else. Bon Jovi. I don't know what I'm talking about.
Do you think that Coldplay is something different right now? Do you think Coldplay is something different right now?
Yeah, I think so.
Everyone's so excited to have you here at Much
Music.
It's
crazy. Jerry Springer.
Chris, you once said that you want to deliver records that will change people's lives. Was that the inspiration for the new album?
Yeah. You're right. Yeah. One word answer, yeah. You're correct.
So where did that come from? What are you hoping to do with A Rush of Blood to the Head?
Well, we were kind of hoping to make the record, the kind of record that we listened to when we were, you know, 13, 14, 15, that made us want to make records in the first place, yeah. You know. The records that made us love music and the bands that made us love music.
Who were those bands growing up?
Uh-huh. Yeah. The Bangles. Do you know these people?
Of course.
No, the Smiths. Will's been into the Smiths for the last few days. Well, for the last few years. But we've been listening to the Smiths and
the Pixies and
Pixies, Oasis, you know, everyone, anyone and everyone.
Good songwriting is really important to the band. What do you think makes a great song? Something you'd listen to?
So the drums. We sometimes bring in songs that are terrible. And Will turns them around like some mad magician. Similarly, he messes up some as well. So it works both ways. What makes a nice pair of trousers? It's an unanswerable question, but we did try.
You did try. So if something goes wrong, do you blame the drummer?
Usually.
Yeah. It's all your fault, Will. We have an audience question over here, Holly.
Hey, with respect to the fair trade issues that you dealt with when you were in Haiti, I was wondering what is the most important experience you brought back home with you?
That's a great question. It's very tricky when bands start getting involved in talking about what they believe in, you know. But we thought that because we kept getting asked to do all these commercials for sneakers and candy bars and all this sort of stuff, that we should just get involved in something that we believed in. And I went to Haiti and like visited all these farms and stuff, you know, and it was just the whole thing of, it was just so removed from like here and America and England and where we all come from, that the whole thing was just a big shock, and you realise how people perceive us, you know, and a lot of them don't like us, you know, and it was just really frightening. But I'm not really an authority, but it's all on this website called maketradefair.com, you know. Because I just went there to be like, to advertise it, you know. We're just dumb models for this cause, you know what I mean? But if we get people looking at these websites and stuff, then that's our purpose.
You mentioned advertising. Coldplay turned down $85 million for music to be used in an ad, from what I read. Is that true? Why did you make that decision?
I think it might have been 8.5.
That's still a lot of money.
It is. We could have afforded new trousers.
Yeah. So obviously that's really important to you, that your music isn't used to sell products.
Definitely. I don't think it's not something that we want to associate ourselves with, you know. Like Chris said, we choose to use our music to advertise good causes and things that we really believe in and things that we, you know, that we use. And so we don't want to advertise fizzy drinks because we don't think they're a good thing.
Do you drink fizzy drinks?
We've made mistakes in the past. Yeah, we do. We drink and we love them.
Okay, yeah. I also read that you don't want your music right now being used in films.
That's not true.
No?
We like our music in films. It's cool.
Yeah.
We were playing in Los Angeles the other day, and we were joking on stage about being in Dude, Where's My Car 2.
Yeah!
And the producer was there. So we, you know, so we're up for it. What can I say? But we films are great. You know, we were just in a film called Insomnia. We weren't in it, but we were. If you listen very, very carefully and ignore what Robin Williams and Al Pacino are saying at one particular point, you can just about hear us. So we really made that film.
We're going on the road right now with Speaker's Corner. We have a question from Vancouver.
Okay.
Hey guys, my name's Karen, I'm from Vancouver, and my question for you is, in songs like Politic, it seems that you're starting to write more about social responsibilities. Why is this important to your band?
Well, this is getting deep. It's funny that song, which is the first song of our new album, is it just came out in about 5 minutes in my kitchen, and then we played it in the studio the next day in about 10 minutes. And so it wasn't like sitting down and considering what we were writing. It was just a sort of stream of consciousness thing. And I don't know, it's the first sort of angry song we've ever had, you know? And I've forgotten the question, but I think...
Why is it social responsibility?
Yeah. I mean, you're making us out to be angels, and we're really not. It's not, I mean, it's just a... what am I trying to say, Will?
It's just a bunch of songs.
Yeah, we're just a bunch of guys. Shucks.
Song must be important to the band since you start off a lot of your sets with it.
Yeah, you know, it is. It's about not wasting time in your life and not putting up with nonsense from authority or whatever. You know what I mean? You know, anyone that is just, I can't say the word, but anyone that's
git.
A git. Anyone that's a git is about not putting up with gits. Can we say git on the Canadian TV?
You just did.
Okay, that's not a rude word. Anyway, whatever, it's about just not being afraid of anyone and not being afraid about expressing yourself and all that, because we had a lot of flack given to us, especially in Britain on our last record, you know. And there was a point when we thought, oh, maybe we shouldn't carry on. And then we thought, no, forget everyone else. We'll just, you know, do what we believe in, and that's that.
We have an email. Yeah. This is a very popular question. Hi, Coldplay. I was interested to find out what your involvement is with Oxfam. What projects have you helped out with so far? Thanks for your time. Rush of Blood is awesome. That's from Sadia. So with Oxfam, you mentioned the trip to Haiti. What else you're doing? I know, Chris, that's you wear it. The T-shirt on stage, yeah. And at concerts, you have booths set up.
Yeah, that's it, yeah.
You don't really do
like,
anything.
Like what we said to that lady over there.
Okay, nothing else to add to that?
No, because I'm just going to make an idiot of ourselves. But look at that website, maketradefair.com.
Okay. Do you think there's enough protest in music right now? I mean, everyone's really excited about this. We just had three questions about social responsibility and issues. And maybe that's because not a lot of other bands are speaking to these topics.
Yeah, I think in popular music seems to be kind of governed by money making money for the people that don't necessarily sing the records, but you know, I think a lot of people get bogged down with that, and not enough people accept the responsibility that they have. You know, the music that people create, and that these people that sing these songs are responsible for kind of talking to a different age group of people that may not actually hear about these issues from other media. So I think it is important that people stand up and say something.
We still sing mainly about girls, but it's just you know, it was just something we wanted to put in our album about what we believed in. You know, we're not nearly as active as people like Rage Against the Machine were, or Pearl Jam. You know, there's loads of people who are doing cool things, Radiohead and U2 and all them, and it's just bands that we really like are always expressing themselves, and so we thought, oh, we'll try as well.
Keeps coming back to music. Mm-hmm. I wonder if you think the music business, the music industry, is even about music anymore.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah?
Yeah. I mean, it's always money and music, you know. There was no golden age where it wasn't about that. It's, you know, there's people there to sell records, and there's people there who just love making them, you know.
Mm-hmm. And the people that love making them often get swindled by the people who love selling them. In fact, we were talking today about the old blues artists, you know, because we had a... we've had some weird money stuff going on, because once bands start selling records, everyone wants a piece of the money, whatever. And we were talking about the old blues guys who used to sell their songs for about $25, you know, and then people would make millions and millions off them. And what am I saying? I'm losing touch because of all these people outside.
And they're outside in the rain. We have a phone call we're going to take right now. Linda in St. John. Hi, Linda. Linda, do you have a question for Coldplay?
She wants a pizza.
Yeah. 12 slices of pepperoni. Try again, Linda. Are you there?
Whoa.
Okay, we'll check back with Linda in a little
she
bit.
She probably had to go to the bathroom or something.
Maybe something like that. As artists, you have a lot of control over what you put out there. Not only your music, your artwork, your videos. Why is that important to you? And how did you establish that early on when you were a new artist? Just
good
happy
question.
To get your music out there.
You know, we I don't know if you had American Idol here, but...
Oh, yeah.
Okay. But to us, that's our nightmare, you know, is someone... I mean, when we auditioned for our band,
just bitter.
No, but when it's our nightmare. For, when we first started doing photo shoots and stuff, people would say, "Well, perhaps you should wear this," and we all got really upset. Not upset by it, but it just felt wrong. And so, right from the beginning, we've always not wanted to be involved in every decision. You know, of course, because it's our band. You know, it's what we live for. You know.
When I look at the four of you, you're just four guys.
Yeah,
no
four
visible.
Very handsome guys.
Thanks.
Sorry, four very handsome guys. But
one particularly handsome.
But no visible tattoos, no sunglasses, no big styled hair. At one point.
What are you saying, man? No, no, all right.
I want to know if that's something you had to fight early on.
What?
Is being marketed in a way you weren't comfortable.
Are you saying we look terrible?
No, I'm not. I'm saying you look like regular people that I can relate to. You're not larger than life.
Right. Will, feel this question. This jacket cost $16.
Nice. Where did you get it?
I can't remember. I'm making it up. Well, because, I don't know, we'll wear sunglasses sometimes.
Yeah?
Yeah.
During interviews?
Never, no. See, but that stuff's all nonsense, you know. Whenever you see, like, I don't know, I don't want to slag anyone off, but whenever you see some people who are wearing sunglasses and behind all the, you know, like, I don't do stairs stuff, you know, it's nonsense, you know. We're all just these little creatures who, some of us are really good at being in the Coldplay band, and some of us are doctors. You know what I'm saying? No, forget it. But sunglasses and us just don't go.
Okay, we're going to try the phone call again. Linda, are you there?
Hi.
What's your question for the band?
I just want to see you guys are grooving. Your music's beautiful, really. And my question, what mark do you want to leave in the world of music, in the music world? Is there a mark you want to leave? What do you want people to say, like, you know, years from now?
I'll take this. This is funny. Someone asked us this the other day, and we were, you know, I don't know if you have these compilation CDs, like the best album of all time. Well, we one day when the world is actually blown up by George Bush, it'd be nice if it'd be great if before that happens, i.e., like before next week, someone could make a CD called "The Best of the World Ever." And just post it into space, and we'd like track one and track four. and that'd be great. And then we'll have the Beatles and Mozart and some other cats.
You mentioned George Bush and the situation we're in today. Mm-hmm. You think it's a scary time?
Definitely.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Cool, yeah.
Don't you?
And are you able
Don't
to
you?
Deal with that as artists? Is it a way for you to kind of like figure out what's going on by making music?
We live
music
in a little bubble of amazing jobness, you know.
Yeah.
We don't really function in the. I mean, we have this mad bubble life, which is amazing. And if even we're frightened, then we live in la la land. Then you know, it's scary. It's scary. But we don't want to dwell on that. Let's talk about Nelly.
More music, we're taking a break, but we're getting intimate and interactive with Coldplay.
In New York.
Welcome back. You're watching Much Music, Intimate and Interactive with Coldplay. It's time for an intimate performance with the band. Coldplay, it's all you!
here, got somebody to lean on.
Thanks, sir.
Okay, well.
We'll be right back.
Questions answered. Don't go anywhere. Our intimate and interactive with Coldplay continues. This is the Q&A session. They're yelling, come outside, come outside. So I think it's about time. It stopped raining. Are you ready for Coldplay?
Thanks for waiting out here, you know.
We have an audience question. It might be difficult to hear, but go for it. What's your name?
Hi, Chris. I was wondering, how is it that you got to collaborate with Ron Sexsmith on his new latest album?
Oh, great. We'd love to talk about Ron Sexsmith. Ron Sexsmith is this amazing Canadian songwriter who should really be like as big as Garth Brooks, you know, but people haven't seen since. But we met in Australia. He came and played with us in Australia, and we were really into his record Blue Boy, and we just met and we chatted, and it was that. It was cool. No problem.
I saw him at the Toronto concert.
Yeah,
I came out.
Ron, he's great, you know. Everyone goes on about Celine Dion being the greatest thing from Canada, but Ron Sexsmith is better.
I think they'd agree. Thank you, everyone. We're gonna go back inside
okay.
now.
All right. Okay. Thanks for waiting, everyone. That was very brief. That was very quick.
Yeah, don't worry, I'm sure we can go out again.
Okay, thanks.
Coldplay is an emotionally driven band.
Right.
I want to know, if music was marketed by emotion instead of genre, where would we find Coldplay in the record store? Under which emotions?
That's a ridiculous question.
But do you think it's fair to be marketed as a pop band? Or is a rock band?
We don't really think about that, you know?
No?
We don't think, like you said, we're not really that sort of, we don't think about that.
Okay, then let me rephrase the question. Since you write a lot of songs about girls, what kind of emotions are going through your mind when you're putting the songs together, when you're performing them on stage? What are you feeling when you close your eyes and you're performing the music?
Well, you know, every song that we write, hopefully, is sincere, you know? We have a lot of songs that just get thrown away because they don't quite work, they don't quite feel proper, you know? Because we know that if we write a song these days, we have to play it 500 times or whatever, so we make sure that we like it, you know, and that we really can mean it when we sing it. And but it could be anything, you know? You can be passionate about vegetables if that's what you're into, you know? It doesn't have to be about any one thing, it's just, as long as when you're singing that song, you don't feel like you're pretending to be someone else, you know?
Mm-hmm. I like vegetables.
Like, exactly. Well, write a song about it.
Okay. It's time for another Speaker's Corner question.
Right. Okay.
Let's have a look.
Hi, my name is Valerie from Montreal, and my Coldplay question is, you've mentioned going through a difficult period following the release of your first album, Parachutes. And I would like to know what it was that kept you going when you might have had strong doubts about pursuing your career in music.
Well, after we cancelled a couple of tours, Chris lost his voice, and we were all ill and miserable and being, well, really stupid, I think. And we just went into the rehearsal room and we wrote some more songs, and we suddenly got excited and thought maybe we'll be able to do a second album, and there was kind of light at the end of the tunnel, and so we suddenly got excited again and wanted to play and realised what idiots we'd been for, you know, being so miserable about everything.
We suddenly got really happy and excited about the police. Sorry.
You?
They found out about these shoes being stolen.
Oh, they're hot.
No, but we just got some new tunes and we realised that we had quite a good job, so we got excited, and that's what kept us going.
Do you struggle with insecurity as artists?
Not anymore, though.
No. We're going to take a phone call right now from Ottawa, Chantal. Chantal?
Chantal.
Yeah.
How are you doing?
Chantal.
Good, thanks.
Hello, Chantal.
Hi. Just want to say, like everyone else, that the new album is amazing.
Thank you.
And it's been on repeat in my CD player for over a week. Okay, so my question is, considering that you're one of the few modern British rock bands to actually make it big in North America, do you find your band is perceived differently in North America than in the UK?
I'll take that. A bit. We get a lot more whooping in America. You know, in England, no one cheers when we say anything. And over here, if you say the word biscuits, everyone goes cracking. You see, it's a little hard for us to get used to, but we love it. I mean, we love it, but... So we're perceived as being a lot cooler, I think. No, we're not. But the thing is, we do okay. We do really well where we come from, but British people are a lot more reserved, you know? Mm-hmm. And so we feel like people are more vocal about liking us.
But the British press is very vocal. They're not reserved at all.
No.
How do you deal with that?
Well, we've been through everything with them. They've loved us and then hated us and loved us again, you know what I mean? And so we... It always... You see... No one would say that in England. In England, they say, oh, we think you're not there.
Do you ever get heckled in
certain
often, crowds?
Yeah.
What do people yell out?
They often yell out about Johnny. What they'd like to do to him.
No, I don't.
We have an audience question. Christian?
Hi, guys. I have a question for you. In your video, In My Place, if you notice, in the middle of the video, there's two guys at the back on the stairs, and in the middle, you run to the guy in the back, and then come back. Who are those two guys?
They're two girls.
Two girls. It was, what do you mean, oh?
Cindy Crawford.
And Whitney Houston.
And Whitney Houston.
And I went over them to say, you are rubbish. Bye. No, I didn't. We went over. Sorry.
No, they're two girls. One of them is called Faith, and the other one is called, what was her name? Louise, was it?
Louise. Faith, yeah. Good, nice. And the truth is, they were just sat there, and they had to sit there for the director said, oh, you should sit in the back, and they work with us, those two girls. And they had to sit there for so long, and they were so bored that I just went over. That was about take 50 or something, so I just went over to say, are you all right? You know, can we get you anything? Oh, I've got to go. The song's still going. And so that was what happened.
Thank you for the question. We have to take a break.
Okay.
But more live music by Coldplay.
Cool.
When
Thanks
we come
you.
Back.
Thank you.
things I shouldn't have crossed. I was so lost, oh yeah.
Performances with, you know, a message for the audience. Quickly, do you have anything you'd like to share?
This has been the most bonkers half an hour of our entire life. That's what we'd like to share. It's been great. And thanks for everyone for standing outside and inside and wherever, you know.
Thank you to Coldplay. Thank you to everyone who came down to Much Music. And thank you to our viewers at home. You still have a couple songs left.
Yeah.
I can't wait.
Okay. Thanks for having us. Oh, right. Let me just explain before we start this song. This is been absolutely mega for you to let us come here and do this. And this is called The Scientist. And we'll see you again soon. Thanks a lot. Bye.
sad.